Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome back. Just a couple of days ago, there was a brand new interview that released via gameindustry.biz with David Vonderhaar. If I'm not mistaken, I think this was the very first public interview that Vonderhaar has done since he left Treyarch back in August of 2023. This is really an excellent interview, and I definitely recommend checking it out. I'll put a link in the description below. In this video, though, I want to talk specifically about some of the things that Vahn had to say about Call of Duty and its departure, mainly because it resonates with me. As someone who's been playing this game for as long as I have and have seen the ups and the downs and everything in between when it comes to this game, there's just so much that I'd like to discuss, and that's pretty much why we're here in this video today. So check out the link down below if you want to see the interview. Let's go ahead and pull out a couple of things here. So you might be wondering, where is Vonderhaar now? He went on to create a brand new studio. He is the head of BulletFarm. It's a AAA studio within NetEase that is a China-based publisher. Of course, this led to the question, why are you working with a China-based publisher? And Vahn simply said, I was really, really impressed by the NetEase ecosystem. The totality of everything behind you that supports you. You're making the studio, you're setting the values for your studio, you're deciding the game you want to make, and then they're just there to help. That's it. It seemed a little too good to be true, so I did a lot of research, called a lot of people, spoke to other studio heads, and it's true. Vahn continues by saying, when you get too big, when you get so big and so popular and so much money at stake, it just gets complicated. The best experiences I ever had making games were the smaller things that got made inside of those larger games. That was what was really fun. That's when I was alive and the team were alive. That's when you got the innovation. That's when people would want to work extra hours. They would want to do things. They would do so because they wanted to, not because they had to or were told to. That's how you should make games. That's the fun part. Can you make a whole game that way? Well, we're going to find out. And that's really what interests me with this new studio and whatever they're cooking up over there. So I'll definitely be keeping tabs on that. But this really does ring true. And I don't know what exactly one piece that Vonderhaar is pointing towards. I mean, we can look back on the entire history of Treyarch and we know that something like zombies was never actually ever intended to be in a Call of Duty game. We know the story of zombies at this point. We know that the zombies future was never meant to actually be a future. It was meant to be a one-off thing in World at War for completing the campaign, and it turned into something so much bigger because they took a risk and they did something different. But not only from the zombies perspective, you know, a big time throughout Call of Duty was like the shakeup of BO3 and BO4 with specialists, and that was so unique and I really liked it. I just remember the passion that Vahn had in his voice when speaking about the specific design choices that were made during this time, like the guns up mentality, which I still to this day don't understand why it was dropped to begin with. Manual healing was a big thing that I think started off kind of rough for a lot of people, but at the end, I think a lot of people really enjoyed the manual healing. And not only that, during that time, we had Blackout. This was our first foray into Battle Royale. And Blackout, I still believe to this day, crawled so Warzone could run. Because during this time, it wasn't equally supported by Activision as Warzone is now today. It didn't really have the same opportunities that Warzone had today. And I find that so sad because there was so much to love about Blackout. It's such a different experience versus Warzone. And I need to make it clear, you know, I'm not taking away from people that absolutely love Warzone but hated Blackout. Blackout to me is a more traditional battle royale experience where looting is the main priority, building up for the end game fight as opposed to just getting your created class every single game. It's a much different experience, and that's why I enjoyed it more. That's why I had thousands and thousands and thousands of wins. That's why I prestiged all the way through. That's why I supported Blackout the way that I did, because there was so much opportunity there, not only for unlocks, but also for nostalgia and transformation of the map itself. It was the first time that we really saw live service done in Call of Duty in a massive scale, and that could very well be what Vonderhaar's talking about here. Unfortunately, as we continue on through this interview, he goes on to mention that he thought his career would end with Call of Duty, and he'd work on it for 18 years, and then he'd retire and be happy with his career. But he said, you can't demolish the things that people like about it. You can only do so much different within something that big. I want the whole game to be different, not just a little bit of this and a little bit of that, this game mode or that mode, right? And I get it. I mean, this is like a perfect example of what's currently going on with Call of Duty today. I'm even guilty of not accepting some of the changes that were made. Some of the changes feel like it was done for the sake of change. For example, the way that perks worked last year with Modern Warfare 2, that rubbed me the wrong way. That was something that just honestly didn't need to change, and they just refused to revert it all year long. And then they did revert it with Modern Warfare 3. I feel like if there's going to be a change, it needs to be a big one that's not just going to affect one section of the game, but literally the entirety of the game. And a good example of that is like the jetpack advanced movement specialist era of Call of Duty. Because not only were you basically required to engage with the advanced movement to either wall run or jump to a specific position or get into a new position or plant a bomb or whatever, it changed up and reprogrammed everybody's brain on how to play. And then it just took it a step further with BO4 and the manual healing. And then it took it a step further once again when we got the introduction of Blackout and how that just changed the entire landscape of Call of Duty. And now with Warzone, I feel like they are too scared to change anything. They kind of tried to make sweeping changes with Warzone 2, even rebranding it as Warzone 2. But at the same time, they shot themselves in the foot because they said, hey, Warzone 1 is going out the window. And they forced everybody to go to Warzone 2. And everyone's like, this shit is whack. Why are we going to play this? It feels so much worse than the original Warzone. And then they spent all year catching up. And even still to this day in Modern Warfare 3, it feels like they're still trying to play catch up. It gets really frustrating, especially when you realize Warzone really hasn't done much to change outside of becoming a thing back in 2020. Then trying to change itself, but utterly failing at it, then spending an entire year reverting itself, and then spending this year basically giving back nostalgia in the form of Fortune's Keep, Verdansk on Warzone Mobile, and now Rebirth Island is coming back, and they're really playing into that because they took it away, now they're bringing it back, and it just seems like this is constantly happening over and over and over again with subtle changes here and there. This is definitely an unfortunate situation because this is what the players want. This is exactly what players want. It's the same idea of players want shipment 24/7, every single day, all year long, forever at this point now, because it's the easiest map to get camos on, it's the fastest way to rank up, it's the fastest way to earn weapon XP, and Call of Duty, I feel, really has boxed itself in a corner to where if it diverts or changes in any way, shape, or form, even just the slightest, it turns into a giant shit fest, and it's really unfortunate, and it's kind of sad because we're not seeing any type of innovation whatsoever in Call of Duty. And the sad part is I don't think we will, at least anytime soon. I don't think that there's going to be anything crazy happening within the next Black Ops game that hasn't already been said or seen or done. I mean, they're already starting to tease the Perseus storyline again in Rebirth Island, which is cool. I like the Perseus storyline, but from a gameplay perspective, in recent years, when it comes to this franchise, it's really taking shit in one hand and wish in the other. What are you going to get first? It takes that to an entirely new level, and I kind of understand why Vahn decided to move on and go make his own studio so he could do something new, because unfortunately, I really do feel like the franchise is stuck in this position where there's really not going to be any innovation. There's going to be gameplay changes for the sake of change that's probably going to make it worse overall. And if there are any good changes, it's basically just going to be a reversion to the bad changes that were made in the previous year. But who knows? You know, the newest Call of Duty game coming out this year has been worked on longer than any other COD game in the history of COD games. It could be something that blows all of our minds and surprises us unlike anything we've ever seen before. And I'm definitely looking forward to seeing the continuation of not only the campaign, but also the zombie story. Hopefully we'll see a pretty cool zombie story. Unfortunately, though, when it comes to my hype levels for the upcoming Call of Duty game, even with the leaks, normally I'm just like super hyped. I'm already riding the train. I can't wait to get more information. I'm just I don't feel like I'm on the train at this point. I kind of feel like I'm laying on the tracks and I'm just looking for the train. And if I see it off in the distance and something looks pretty cool, I might get up off the track and try to jump onto the train. Otherwise, I think I'm just going to let that thing barrel over me, because at this point, I've been playing Call of Duty for over half of my life, and I just can't get excited for the game like I used to. And I know that there are people out there that are living in their golden era right now. They might not know it yet. You might be someone that's playing this game and you're living your best life right now and you don't even know it. 5 years from now, looking back to playing Call of Duty, you might say, man, that was the best time. That was when I enjoyed this game the most. And you're going to look back on it in fond memories. And those are memories that are being created today, whether it's with friends or creating an amazing play on Warzone or just solving an Easter egg or being first in the world to get a new blueprint or doing something like that. These are the memories that are being created today that will be looked back on and say, man, I really wish we could go back to that time for this generation. That's how a lot of us feel about, you know, old Call of Duty. And some of us feel about the jetpack Call of Duty. We kind of wish we can go back to that era. Nothing's stopping us from going back to those games. But, you know, I wish that we can get something like that with the new amenities that the new games offer, like FOV slider and better graphical fidelity and things like that. But, hey, here's to hoping that maybe we can get a unique game mode that offers us jetpacks and things like that. And I think that really does tie into what Vonderhaar was talking about. There's really no way to innovate without messing with the almighty dollar, especially with a franchise that's so big. So I'm looking forward to seeing what he's doing with Bullet Farm. I believe the interview mentioned that there's only 15 employees there at the moment. He's working in a much smaller team. So I can't wait to see what comes of this studio many years away still. So yeah, that's it. If you've watched to this point in the video, I just want to say thank you. I've been rambling, so I apologize, but I just wanted to share my thoughts and feelings about this. I wish you nothing but the best of luck. I can't wait to see what your studio ends up creating in the next few years, hopefully. And yeah, that's pretty much it. If you want to check out that interview, link in the description below. Thank you so much for watching. Drop a like if you enjoyed. Subscribe for more. And I'll see you on the next one. Peace.